Imagine you're a black man who gets sent back to the times of slavery. That's a tough situation that two half-brothers, Joel and Regis, have found themselves in the French comedy movie Cased Apart. The movie starts with a man named Joel, who has just gotten out of prison following a 3-month sentence. In those 3 months, Joel has converted to Islam, which his dear friend Kadar is very happy to hear, and hopes his friend finally turns his life around for good. And to do so, Kadar suggests that Joel get a job and get back into society. However, Joel tells him that he can't work for the whites as he considers it slavery. Kadar even tells him that he'll get him employed at a building firm, but Joel strictly rejects the offer, claiming that he has a child to look after. Well, if you have a child to look after, the wise thing would be to get a job. Anyway, Kadar wishes him luck and hopes to see him at the mosque. Just then, Joel sees a French girl and can't stop staring at her butt while commenting on how he will love to grab it. Kadar's jaw drops listening to the lecherous comments from his newly converted Muslim brother. Within minutes of getting out of jail, Joel is yet again in trouble for boarding the bus without a ticket. He tries to get away by calling the officers racist and ends up getting kicked out of the bus. He then returns home, where he finds his enraged mother furious at him for being an embarrassment to her. She beats him angrily and decides to kick him out of the house until he finds himself a job. However, before she could actually kick him out, she gets a call for Joel and hands him the phone. Now moving towards our other character, we see an African woman asking government employee Regis Gros de Serre for help as she has a lot of kids and no place to live. When the lady says that she has no documents to prove that she's a single mother, Regis rudely tells her to go back to Cameroon where she came from. After work, when he's on his way home with his wife and daughter, he encounters a beggar on the street who starts wiping the windshield without his permission. Regis, who thinks that the beggar is a con, steps out of the car and pushes him only to discover his amputated arm. Embarrassed, he sits back in the car and feels guilty. Later at home, he receives a call from his uncle, who breaks the bad news about his father being on the verge of dying. At the airport, he unexpectedly bumps into Joel, who is revealed to be his half-brother. It turns out that their father summoned Joel to see him as well after all those years. In the car, Regis shares that he has set up his own firm, has bought a riverside house, and is happily married, having a 9-year-old daughter. When Regis asks Joel about his life, he feels embarrassed and lies to him that his life is similar to his as he also has a 9-year-old daughter and has bought a house in Paris. Moreover, he adds that he has a firm where he helps poor people. Regis is impressed by him, but finds his behavior sketchy. Upon arriving at their father's house, their uncle Jocelyn takes them to their father where they find a ton of half-sisters. Turns out their father was quite a popular man. Their father becomes happy to see his only 2 sons and apologizes for not being available to them always. As redemption, he offers to give them the family treasure. However, before he could explain it, his condition starts to get worse. Joel, who is desperate for money, yells at him to explain what the treasure is. Suddenly, the father wakes up and reveals that the family treasure is the certificate of freedom that freed their common ancestor from slavery. Uncle Jocelyn explains that the certificate is very precious and must be passed on to generations so that the family does not forget the ancestor's suffering. But the brothers see no value in it and tear it into pieces just for fun. As the two half-brothers tear the sacred document and mock it, their aunt observes them and, in her rage, she casts a spell to send them back to the 18th century. Upon waking up in a field, Joel checks his mobile phone and is confused to see that it is a no-network zone. Just then, they see a black man running for his life from the whites. Joel suggests they run, but Regis considers himself innocent. Soon enough, they are captivated in a cage. Regis tries to assure them that he did not do anything wrong, but the white captors don't pay any attention to his words. Freshly captured from Africa's coasts, the half-brothers are marketed as slaves among the others. In the end, all the slaves are sold except Regis and Joel. The white man decides to sell both of them for the price of one, and eventually a man named Mr. Jourdain buys them. When Jourdain's assistant, Henry, assigns them laborious tasks, Regis tries to clarify that he works at town hall. However, he is given a shut-up call and told to speak only when allowed. He is then taken into the kitchen, where he bursts onto a lady slave named Rosalie when she tells him that they are living in 1780. He yells that he is a citizen of the French Republic and has married a white woman, but Rosalie shuts him up. Meanwhile, Joel works under Henry's supervision in the fields and feels humiliated when Henry mocks him for being black. On the other hand, Regis is shocked to hear the ideals of the white people regarding the blacks, whom they consider ordinary and cannibalistic. Mistakenly, he spills a drink on one of the white ladies to end up calling him an ape and mocking his existence. At night, both the half-brothers sit together, discussing their miserable conditions. Joel decides he will not live a life of slavery and heads out. When he asks Regis to join, Regis initially hesitates but then follows him. Meanwhile, Henry approaches Jordane with a suggestion to chain up Joel due to his savage behavior. Jordane tells him to be lenient with Joel and let him settle in. Back to the brothers, they lose their wits after they witness a ghost in the fields and run away to Jordane's servant quarters. In the morning, as per routine, the Roman Catholic father preaches to the blacks about how they are obliged to obey the whites. Regis mentions the idea that all humans must be treated with equality, but the father dismisses it. Later, while working in the fields, Joel disrespects Henry, making him furious. Henry complains to Jordane about it, and as a result, Joel is subjected to severe punishment in front of the entire village. Later, Jordane summons Regis to his office. After finding out that he can read, he considers Regis better than most white people who are uneducated. Surprisingly, he offers Regis to take command of the slaves. Meanwhile, Rosalie treats Joel's wounds and realizes that he is not as robust as all African men. Suddenly, Joel tries to kiss her, but she rejects his advances, telling him that she likes someone else. Joel expresses restlessness as he can't wait to get laid but is unable to find any girl in the village. On the other hand, the Catholic father warns Jordane not to give importance to Regis, telling him that an educated slave can turn out to be dangerous as he might incite the others to revolt. Jordane dismisses his warnings, claiming that he has made Regis totally inoffensive. Soon enough, Regis takes his duties as in charge and orders Joel to get to work. When Joel refuses to comply, Regis throws his piss bucket on him. Henry is envious to see Regis ruling. Joel tells Regis not to become like the whites, but Regis realizes that he has no other choice. He starts considering himself a white and interrupts Jordane's family time to report him about the slaves. When Jordane tells his family that Regis is an educated slave, they mock him by asking if he can play the piano. This bruises Regis's ego, and he gets to the piano and starts playing it while singing poetry. The whites do not like Regis's behavior. The next day, he is tied up in public and beaten the same way as Joel. Finally, Regis realizes the pain suffered by Joel, and together they decide to flee Jordane's plantation. Soon, they get into a Jewish man named Isaac's cart, who trades goods with Jordane. Upon arriving at Isaac's residency, Regis begs him not to take them back to Jordane. Meanwhile, when Jordane finds out that his newly bought slaves have run away, he hires two men to find them. On the other hand, Regis asks Isaac why he is helping them. Isaac explains that the white consider Jews lower class, just like the blacks. Joel and Isaac then get into an argument when Isaac mentions that they suffered more than the blacks. Regis blows off the steam, and just then the slave hunters arrive. Isaac guides Joel and Regis to get away from the back door. Soon, both of them manage to get on a boat, thinking that they can evade the hunters. However, they end up getting caught by other whites and are once again picked up and sold as slaves. Jordane's hunters buy them and decide to take them back to Jordane. However, they mistakenly enter the slaves' territory, known as the Maroons, who broke the chain and managed to escape the whites. Joel and Regis are welcomed with open arms and instructed to fight to the death in order to free their brothers. However, when the Maroons ask them to take a pledge to kill all the whites, Regis hesitates. Considering them as traitors, the Maroons drive them out of their territory. In the morning, Joel and Regis wake up in the middle of a forest and are surprised to find their aunt sitting next to them. Regis realizes that she was the one who cast a spell on them and sent them during slavery years. He loses control and attempts to attack his aunt, but Joel restrains him. The aunt tells them that it was a test to make them experience slavery firsthand. She then explains that their fate is in their own hands, and if they wish to return back home, they must go to their ancestors Isidore and Rosalie and make things right. Joel tells Regis that Isidore can't be their ancestor as he is gay. When Regis refuses to believe him, Joel shows him the picture he captured of Isidore while he was involved in his sexual activity with a man. All of a sudden, Joel realizes that they are sent to make things right by helping their ancestor Isidore reproduce. The duo must help their ancestors to meet and fall in love. Having no other choice but to return to their lives, they go back to the plantation and are brutally punished. Jordane's little son Victor approaches Joel and Regis, asking them about Rosalie. However, upon listening to Joel and Regis talk about the future, Victor is perplexed. He tells his family that soon the monarchy will be abolished and France will be a democracy whose representatives will be elected by the people. His family mocks him and dismisses his thoughts, thinking he is a kid. While there is a wedding ceremony taking place in Jordan's house, Regis and Joel steal a barrel of rum to bring Isidore and Rosalie together. Regis accompanies Isidore, talking to him about Rosalie, whereas Joel accompanies Rosalie. However, Rosalie ends up kissing Joel, trying to make out with him. However, in the end, they manage to get them to sleep together. Thinking that they have accomplished and are about to go back to their lives, Joel and Regis barge into Jordan's house, interrupting their party. Joel kisses Jordan's sisters wildly and Regis ends up smashing a cupcake on Jordan's face. In the end, Henry enters with his sniper, but Jordan stops him, planning to hang Joel and Regis at dawn. The following morning, while Joel and Regis are chained up and aware that they are about to be executed, Joel apologizes to Regis for lying that he has a firm. He reveals that he lived with his mother and had just gotten out of prison. Henry interrupts them and takes them to the gallows in the public square to hang them for their intolerable behavior. However, before they could be hanged, Victor runs to a lake and attempts to drown. Rosalie summons the crowd to the lake, which allows Isidore to knock Henry unconscious and save Joel and Regis. Regis and Joel then save Victor from drowning, and as a result, Victor requests his father to free them. However, Regis rejects freedom and asks Jordan to free Isidore and Rosalie instead. Isidore and Rosalie thank Joel and Regis for freeing them. Henry smokes a pipe, and when he blows smoke, Regis and Joel are sent back to their actual lives. Back in their correct timeline, Joel takes up a job as a construction worker, whereas Regis starts standing up for himself and the African community in his job. The film ends with Regis and Joel freaking out after discovering that their daughters tore the precious document that liberated their ancestors from slavery. This movie has a rating of 5.8 on IMDb. The budget of this movie was around $8.4 million, and at the box office, it earned $16.4 million. I hope you all liked this video. If yes, then make sure to like, comment, share, and subscribe. Until then, bye-bye.